So the most important thing you should know about him is that way back in 1990 on June 23rd, he and his lovely wife Kristen were married, and tonight they went to Lewis and celebrated their 29th anniversary. So let's give them a big round of applause. Bryan and Moak has served in 25 years pastoral ministry in churches from Wisconsin to Ohio to Minnesota. And I'm trying to look at my notes here. Let's see how I do. He has served since 2017 with Converge as, I gotta look now, as the Vice President of Church Strengthening, where he is able to use his passion for and understanding of the local church, and as he personally attests, nothing gives him greater joy than the local church effectively realizing its vision for the sake of Christ's kingdom. So let's give Bryan a big warm Montrose welcome, everybody.
So Minnesota, and most importantly, they gave us our first grandchild, and that's the most important thing. And we got to FaceTime today as part of our anniversary present, so that was great. Now, my daughter lives in the La Crosse, Wisconsin area, and she's getting ready to be married in August to some gorilla. And so that's a whole nother deal. With my son, it was like, you mean you really want to live with him every single day of your life? But my daughter is, are you kidding? You want to steal my daughter away from me? It's just a totally different thing. Anyway, enough about that. Let me pray, and then we'll get going to why we're here tonight, not to hear me babble about my life. Lord, thank you for the fact that you are a great God. You are worthy to be praised. You are worthy for us to lift our hands in awe before you. Lord, we stand in awe of you. And who are we that you would love us so much, that you would send your very best in Jesus, that he might empty himself, becoming like us in every way but one. That is, he was without sin. So he was the perfect sacrifice to take on the death that we deserve because of our sin. Because of not just simply his death, but his resurrection, his victory over death, his victory over sin. God, we stand in awe, and we stand rightly before the Father because of him. We worship you, Jesus. We thank you that we get to be a part of this thing that you established and that you said the gates of hell will not prevail against it in this church, your bride. God, you have put us on mission for the sake of the name of Jesus, and we just pray that you would change us even tonight as we share together and talk together about what it means to be the church. Lord, make Montrose Baptist Church, with all of its history and all of the people that have been transformed because of the good news of Jesus through the ministry of this church, Lord, may its best days be yet to come. May you work even this week through their Vacation Bible School to see the next Billy Graham come up through BBS this week. Who knows? Lord, you know. But Lord, we just pray that you would do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I grew up in church, and my mom was one of the organists of the church that that I grew up in. And when she would play the organ on Sunday morning, she would practice on Saturday morning. It's not like you have organs in your house. So she had to go to the church to practice. And so my sister's a year younger than me, we would go with my mom when she practiced the organ, and we would do one of two things. Either we would try to sneak up from the back — it was quite a bit longer than this — but we would sneak from the back through the pews to try to sneak up on her and scare her. And she always knew that we were there. We could never figure that out. And then the second thing we would do is we would play church. And so these were the days when someone got up front and when you sang the songs, you know, you waved your hands like this. I was a music major, so I kind of know what that means, but I didn't know it at all at the time. And so either my sister and I, one of us would be the song leader, and the other one would sing the songs. And then one of us would preach, and so we switched that off. And then we took an offering. I don't know how we took an offering, because neither of us had any money, but we took an offering. And I'm telling you what, as like 7, 8, maybe 6 years old, we were really good at playing church. I mean, after all, we'd seen it done several weeks and years. Last week, I just turned 52. And I calculate that I have been in church for well over 2,000 Sundays. I include being sick, being on vacation, bedside Baptist, all that sort of thing. And 2,000 Sundays. Not to mention Sunday evening services growing up and Wednesday night services. And oh, by the way, I've been a pastor for 25 years. And, And so I have calculated that I have spent tens of thousands of hours in the church over my lifetime. I mean, if I was good at doing church as a seven-year-old, I'm really good at doing church today. And some of you in this room can do similar sorts of calculations. And you too are really good at doing church. But here's the deal, for me at least, and maybe for some of you as well, the familiarity we have with the church can sort of anesthetize us or make us numb to the real purpose of why we're here. If we're not careful, the traditions that we have, the preferences that we have, the expectations that we come to the church with become our motivators for being at church rather than coming for biblical reasons. The story is told of a young girl who was watching her mom bake a ham for a family gathering, and she noticed that when her mom, right before her mom put the ham in the oven, she cut the ends off the ham. And she said, "Mom, why do you cut the ends off before baking the ham?" And she asked, that's a good question. I think it helps soak up the juices while it's baking, but I don't know for sure. That's just the way that my mom did the ham. Why don't you give her a call and ask her?" So she calls her grandma up on the phone and says, "Grandma, mom's baking a ham and cuts off the ends before placing it in the oven." She said that it's probably to help up soak up the juices, but she's not sure. That's really good question. I do cut off the ends of the ham before baking, but I'm not sure why either. I learned how to cook from my mom. You should ask her. And thankfully, great-grandma was also alive, so she calls great-grandma up, and she says, "Great-grandma, why you cut the ends off the ham? Is it to help soak up the juices?" And the great-grandmother chuckled. She said, "Oh, no, sweetie. I just never had a pan big enough to hold a whole ham, so I always had to cut off the ends to make it fit." I mean, you get the idea, don't you?
Yeah.
We get that. How much of what we do as a church is done because the Bible tells us so? And how much do we do because we've just kind of always done it that way? It's kind of a scary question, I think.
It is.
Jesus said in Mark 2:17, it's not the healthy that... Oh, that's all right. It's not the healthy that need a doctor, but the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. This morning, I want us to come to, or this morning, this tonight. It says this morning right here, but clearly it's not this morning. It's tonight. So this tonight, I want us to come to the doctor's office. And I want us to do a sort of a church checkup by reminding us of the essentials of what the church is to be, so that we might make sure that we are still a hospital for people who need to know the good news of Jesus. So let's start by defining what the church is. And now again, this is going to be a Sunday school lesson for those of you who grew up going to Sunday school. But when we were kids, we learned what the church was. And it's this. It's, this is the church. This is the steeple. Open the door and see all the people. Right? That's what it was. And actually, this little pithy statement that we learned with kids was pretty good. Because it was a reminder that the church was really about the people inside the building and not the building itself. Well, maybe we could share a more adult definition that I found in a commentary that I think is, moving. All right, cool, excellent. A better definition, a more adult definition, and I think it's helpful, but it's a little complicated, so hang in there with me. It says this, the fellowship of those given by Christ to be to each other what he has been to them, so that together they can be to the world a demonstration of the new humanity he died and lives to make possible. Let me kind of pick that apart so that it makes more sense, because it's a little bit complicated. The definition starts again. The fellowship of those given by Christ. That means that it begins by reminding us that the church is made up of redeemed people saved by the matchless grace of Jesus. We received that redemption because Jesus gave himself for us by dying the death that we deserved when he died that death on a cross. He took on our sin, the sin that we were supposed to die for, so that through him we might be forgiven of our sin. The second part of the definition says, to be to each other what he has been to them. So, simply put, we are to live a life of love and sacrifice to each other that mirrors the love and sacrifice that Christ gave to us. So we need to look like what Jesus did for us, okay? Finally, the definition says, so that together they can be to the world a demonstration of the new humanity he died and lives to make possible. And what that means is we need to behave like this with each other, this sort of unity and love with each other, so that together we can show the world something that they haven't seen in any other place. We become the example of a new way to live, a new humanity that Christ has made possible. And let me just tell you tonight that we have never been in more need of seeing that new humanity behave itself than today. We live in a completely fractured world, a fractured country where people can't even really have conversations with each other. We can be that different kind of humanity as the church. So I love this definition. I love it because it reminds us that as the collective body of Christ, our purpose is to live in such community with each other that people see a difference in the way that we behave so that they're compelled to want to be a part of it, and oh, by the way, they're welcomed to be a part of it. Unfortunately, the church doesn't always communicate this type of unity. Instead, the church often communicates this sort of disunity that becomes far less than attractive to the world. Tom Rainer, a writer, wrote an article, 25 Silly Things Church Members Fight Over. These are real things that have caused disunity in churches. I'm only going to read a few of them. First, number one, an argument over the appropriate length of the worship pastor's beard. I mean, that's a big one. Number two, a fight over whether or not to build a children's playground or to use the land for a cemetery. A church dispute of whether or not to install restroom stall dividers in the women's restroom. A 45-minute heated argument over the type of filing cabinet to purchase, black or brown, 2, 3, or 4 drawers. A big church argument, get this, over the discovery that the church budget was off by 10 cents. Someone finally gave a dime to settle the issue. A dispute in the church because the Lord's Supper had cran grape juice instead of grape juice. Now that's a real sin. Let's just be honest about that. That should never happen. Business meeting arguments about whether the church should purchase a weed eater or not. It took 2 business meetings to resolve. An argument on whether the church should allow deviled eggs at the church meal. Number 9, a disagreement over using the term potluck instead of pot blessing. And then number 10, a church member was chastised because she brought vanilla syrup to the coffee server. It looked too much like liquor. It's just terrible. The sad thing is, though, these are true. These actually happened in churches. And I could share examples of this kind of stupidity that we behave like in churches all too often. Issues about the color of the carpet, issues about whether or not we're going to have pews or chairs, or whatever the issue is, we tend to argue about silly things. To share a personal example that's not so silly, my dad isn't a believer. He doesn't know Jesus as the Savior, and I know that my dad needs to figure out his relationship with Christ. It's his responsibility, and it's his eternity on the line. But I do believe that one of the reasons that he has not been willing to engage with Christ is because he has seen Christian people behaving poorly. One specific example happened to him personally several years ago. My dad had been playing on the church softball team, and he was easily the best player on the team. And softball is a great place to share life with those like my dad who don't know Christ. However, it was decided one year by some brilliant person that you couldn't play on the church softball team anymore if you weren't a member of the church. So my dad wasn't invited to play anymore. I'm convinced that this scar, among others along the way, is why my dad doesn't want to come to church. I think this story can be played out over over again. Maybe we've forgotten why we exist. Maybe we've twisted the purposes of the church to look more like we want it to look rather than what God intends for it to look. So what is the church supposed to look like? Well, we're going to find out in Acts, the book of Acts, in chapter 2 of the book of Acts, the church is born. And we know that this church was born from this ragtag group of people, about 120 people, who had just experienced some of the most extreme ranges of emotions that anybody could experience. From this unbelievable grief when their Messiah had died, to the sudden ecstasy of he is risen, just as he said. And then within this short amount of time, this real confusion and kind of what's going on when Jesus returns and then all of a sudden he moves up into the sky and disappears before them as he ascends up to heaven. Can you imagine what's going on, really? And then before he ascends to heaven, they're told to wait. They're told to wait for the arrival of the Holy Spirit who's going to empower them to boldly share the good news of Jesus. So they wait. I don't know how many days. Should we wait a couple of days? I suppose we could wait a week. A week turns into 2 weeks. 2 weeks turns into 3. What's going on? Jesus sent us. We got to get back to fishing. We got to get back to life. When is this Holy Spirit going to come? Well, we know he did come, right? Mm-hmm. He came in power. And these tongues of fire. I mean, how bizarre was that to look at God sitting on top of people's heads and people were talking in all sorts of different languages, not the languages of their culture, but all sorts of different cultures. And in all the spiritual energy that the people who saw this could muster, they said they must be drunk. Well, they weren't drunk. It was only 9 o'clock in the morning. This was something different. God did an amazing thing at that day of Pentecost. And it's here that the church, the very church that we participate in 2,000 years later, was born. And in chapter 2, verses 42 to 47, Luke, the writer of Acts, tells us what this new church looked like. And I want to read that together. You'll see it on the screen too, but if you've got your Bibles or a phone that looks like a Bible, feel free to turn there. Verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, breaking of bread and the prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those were being saved. Verse 42, at the beginning of this, shares 4 main functions of this early church. I would call them 4 foundational pillars of what the church was to focus on. So in verse 42, they devoted themselves. They didn't just go through the motions, by the way. You see that word? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, number one. The early church put a priority on the teaching of the Word. Remember, this was only the Old Testament that they had. They didn't have the New Testament yet. It was happening. The New Testament was happening before their eyes. So all they had was the Old Testament, but they devoted themselves to knowing the Word of God. And so if Montrose Baptist Church is going to be the church that God wants it to be, it has to continue to be a church that puts a priority on the Word of God. Says secondly that they devoted themselves to the fellowship. This word for fellowship, it's a Greek word that means koinonia. It doesn't mean koinonia, it is koinonia. And it speaks of freely giving of yourselves for each other in deep community. So koinonia, this thing, this coming together in faith, in love, and encouragement. So that this new church devoted themselves for caring for each other in real ways, to loving each other as family, to building each other up in the faith and encouraging each other to grow. And really the challenge for us tonight is in this area can be summed up with this question. Are you a friendly church Or are you a church of friends? I'm telling you what, we have 240 churches that convert to Mid-America. I've been in well over 100 of them in 2.5 years, and every single church says the same thing. Well, what kind of church are you? Well, we're a really friendly church. Every church is friendly. There's not one who doesn't think that they're friendly. But are you a church of friends? You see the difference there? A friendly church is just being nice to people. But being a friend means that you give up yourself to people in real relationship. It's taking that 3 a.m. phone call from someone because you love and you care for them. They devoted themselves thirdly to the breaking of bread. This had two aspects to it. The first was coming together for communion. Jesus said, "Do this whenever you do this in remembrance of me." He wanted the church to remember his body that was given and his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of sin. The Lord's Supper reminds us of why we are the church. But the breaking of bread also meant, here's an idea, that they came together to share a meal. And you guys have done that a lot today. It's been awesome. There's something powerful about coming together around food. This community that's built. It also reminds us of this importance of hospitality. We need to make our home a place of invitation and welcome. And then lastly, they devoted themselves to prayer. It was not simply an addition to what they did, but rather it was an integral part of who they were as a church. And if you read through the book of Acts, you see that because the people, this early church was praying, God did amazing things. They prayed in their homes as well as the temple. So if we're going to be the church that God wants us to be, we must be a praying church. And so are you all known as a church that prays? Do you pray in structured ways? You know, you have prayer meetings, but do you pray in spontaneous ways? You know, like come on a Sunday night and there's people praying over there in the corner. Someone says, "Well, what are they doing over there?" "Oh, they're just praying." It happens all the time around here. It's just sort of this muscle that just gets exercised all the time. We need to be devoted to prayer. And as the church focused on these four pillars, that devoting themselves to teaching the word, the fellowship, breaking of bread and prayer, then verses 43 to 47 shares these amazing results that took place. As the people got serious about God in these ways, he did amazing things. First of all, everyone was filled with awe. They experienced a reverent fear for what God was doing in their midst. They knew they were just ordinary fisherman-type people. God was doing something extraordinary in their midst, and how could you do anything else but to just be in awe of what God was doing? Secondly, wonders and miraculous signs were done. These wonders and miraculous signs were unexplainable works of the Holy Spirit in the lives of these early believers. It was a reminder of Jesus' promise in Acts 1:8 that the Spirit's power would be them, because you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Brothers and sisters, that power from the Holy Spirit comes to us even today. Number three, they wanted to meet every day. Can you imagine that? I mean, seriously, you want to go to church every single day? Well, I thought only pastors' kids had to do that. You know, oh my goodness. This early church couldn't get enough of what God was doing in their midst. They made a point to meet every day. Can you imagine if that script was flipped? That God was so on the move at Montrose Baptist Church that you just wanted to be here every day. You didn't want to miss out on what God was doing. Number four, everyone was living in unity. They lived with everything in common. They were of one mind and of one mission. Can you imagine that? It didn't last forever. It was awesome what God was doing. Number five, they had an overflowing generosity. These people couldn't give enough to each other. any need because everything was being shared among the people. Isn't that cool? Doesn't sound very capitalistic, but it's pretty cool. No one had any need because everything was being shared. And by the way, these weren't necessarily rich people. I'm sure there was a couple of rich people among them. We hear about it a little bit in Scripture. But most of them were just kind of blue-collar, fisherman-type people with not a lot of money. And yet they gave generously. Number six, they had an abundant hospitality. It says in the passage it's an abundant hospitality. They were very hospitable. The Middle East culture in that day, even today, has a reputation of being a hospitable culture. And so for the Scriptures to say that these people were specifically hospitable, it had to be a really big deal, quite the picture to see. They had the favor of all the people. So all these things were happening among them. The people in the community were noticing. Remember that definition of the church. There was this fragrant smell emanating from the church that became intoxicating to people who were in the community. They saw a different humanity in this new church, and they wanted to see what was going on. Because of that, it says that the Lord added to their number every other month those who were being saved. Wrong answer. The Lord added to their number what?
Every day.
Daily.
Every day.
Every day the Lord was adding to their number. Oh yeah, but that was just the early church. That's not really for today. You can't imagine the hard-hearted people that are here in Chicago. No. The Holy Spirit was moving in power. He wants to move in that same sort of power today. It's the amazing result of the church being on mission. By boldly committing to these four pillars, God added to their numbers, not annually, not monthly, not even weekly, but daily, those who were being saved. So that's just what they did, those four essentials, those four foundational pillars. It was their focus. And then God did all this stuff. It was He who did that. They weren't distracted by lesser, unimportant things, but they were unified with the mission of Matthew 28 in front of them. Therefore, Go. Make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. So, Montrose Baptist Church. What's the name of your church again?
Orangeville
Baptist Church. Or Orangeville what?
Baptist
Church. All right, so I'm including you too. Montrose Baptist Church and Orangeville Baptist Church, all right? Are you, as a church, the bride of Christ, living on mission with the Great Commission as your marching orders? That's the question. Let me close by asking four other questions that I think will help you assess the answer to that question. The first is this. Are you focused on the essentials? Are you focused on the essentials? In other words, as you evaluate the things that you do, are they saturated in the Word? Are they creating real koinonia fellowship? Is there a sense of rich generosity within your people? And are you filling the hallways with regular and persistent prayer? Just ask that question. Secondly, if your church closed its doors today, would your community care? Kind of a scary question.
It is.
In other words, is the impact of your church so intoxicating to the people, having the favor of all the people, that they would be lost if you guys weren't here anymore? Or instead, do you kind of isolate yourself in such a way that your community, well, they don't even really know that you're here. They need to know we're here. They need to know that we care about their community, the community that we're in. The third question may be the most dangerous, and that's this. If the Holy Spirit left your church today, would anything that you do change? So here's a little illustration for that. I just read recently that a group of Chinese pastors came to America because they wanted to see God must be really up to something in America, because look at all that they have done and the resources that they've poured out throughout the world. And so this group of Chinese pastors from the underground church in China came to visit churches in America. And so these these American church leaders, of course, they're going to take them to all the churches you think you should go to when you were coming to show off what God is doing in America. And so they went to all these churches, and at the end, they said to this group of Chinese pastors, "So now that you've seen the American church, what are your reflections?" And they said in unity, they said, "We are amazed. We are astonished at how much you can do without Jesus." If the Holy Spirit left our church, how much of what we're doing would change? In other words, are we doing church in the power of our own strength and the power of our own ideas, of our own preferences, or are we fully dependent on the power of the Holy Spirit working through us? Pretty convicting. Finally, for each of us as individual parts of the body, are you personally living in unity with your church, or are you instead participating in divisive behavior or disunity that you need to confess? We got a lot of bitterness going on in our churches, a lot of unlove going on. So Matthew 5:23-24 says this. Jesus says, "Therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift." Jesus isn't saying don't offer your gift. He said don't offer your gift if you have bitterness and unlove and unforgiveness towards someone else. Go take care of that first. Go take care of that brother or sister in Christ, and then come back and do that. Brothers and sisters, the church is a living and breathing organism. It's an alive thing. It's different than an organization like the Red Cross or the Lions Club or something. Some of these are really good things, but they're not living and breathing like the bride of Christ is. And that's why I love the church. It's why I've devoted my entire life to it. It's why Pastor Jason is devoted to the church. Quite frankly, because of the personalities, the backgrounds, the life experiences of each individual person, there's absolutely no way that the church should work. To me, the proof that it's the bride of Christ is that it works. So we need to know as we leave this place tonight, we need to understand very clearly that we are on mission for Him. As long as He tarries, as long as He holds off His coming to make all things right, He has given us a mission to do. And that mission is holding the hope of the gospel in our hands and holding the hope of the gospel on our lips. And here's the cool thing. We get to do it together. We get to link arms together and we get to go get them. We get to go be what Christ needs and wants us to be for the sake of His name and for His glory. And so we press on together and we cling to the charge of Hebrews 10:25 that says, "Let us not forsake meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage each other, and all the more as we see the day, that capital D day, approaching." Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, as I said this morning, a message like this, as I'm sort of in a way pointing a finger outward, there are three fingers pointed back at me. And God, my biggest fear, I don't know if that's the right word, but worry is that I'm going to stand before you and you're going to say, "Look at all the unopened gifts. Look at all the ways that you wanted to use me that I just was stuck in my rut." So God, I just pray for each person here today that you would fan into flame the gifts that you've given us, that we would use them for the sake of your glory and not for the name of Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, that you would do immeasurably more than we could ask. God, you want to use Montrose Baptist Church. You want to use Orangeville Baptist Church. You want to use these churches for the sake of the name of Jesus and for your glory. use us, Lord. Use us to draw men and women and boys and girls to you. And God, I pray that you would do that even this week as these two churches link arms together. Such a great picture. And share the good news of Jesus with all these kids. God, I just pray that you would draw some to yourself. I pray that you would change the leaders this week. God, that you would change us, that you would transform us, that we would look more and more like Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. In whose name we pray. Amen.